this resort since I was 14 years old, so I've been coming here 40 years. I used to come here with my parents because there was a medical conference that was held here. And 36 years ago, on the beach right out front, I found an entire bale of marijuana. Isn't that cool? I know, it's like I found love at Ponte Vedra. No, I found an entire bale of Ponte Vedra. But I love this place. I've always come here. You want me to be on stage? Man, I'm shy. Can I take my water? But anyway, I love this place. I love speaking for Michael. Michael is one of the more prepared meeting planners that I work with, and he has some of the more interesting conferences. And so when he asked me to speak, I just always just, you know, say what day and come out and talk to him. Now, what I wanted to ask y'all something. How many of y'all were pulling for the Cubs? Tell the truth. You want to know something weird? All right. So it's been how many years since the Cubs had that drought? 108. All right. How many stitches are there on a Spalding baseball? Have y'all heard this? And what's the distance between left and right foul poles to the pole or to the home base of Wrigley? It's 108 meters. Isn't that weird? Was that the best game ever, or is it just me? I mean, especially when they went to rain delay. It's like, thanks a lot, guys. All right, I'm here. This is an innovation conference. And generally when you do that, when you go to innovation conferences, there's lots of innovation conferences around. In fact, if you Google it for 2016, you wind up getting 625,000 conferences on innovation. Everybody talks about innovation. Everybody talks about disruptive innovation. If you look on Amazon, there's 77,000 books on innovation, most of them by Clay Christensen, whose work I follow really closely. Now, I love that guy. And there's another guy y'all should read. Do y'all follow Horace Dedu? Does anybody follow him? He's at asymco.com, asymco.com. I think he's the most forward thinker on innovation that we have right now. But I was thinking about innovation, and I was trying to think of a different way you could sort of look at it. And I was influenced by Nassim Taleb, who wrote The Black Swan, wrote a book recently called Anti-Fragile, where he talked about how lots of little banks is a more robust system than a few big banks. That was the concept. And I was like, all right, well, can you look at innovation that way? Is there sort of a new way to look at innovation? And I was like, well, let's go back and look at some companies that were thought of as being the most innovative companies in their time and see what has happened to them. I'm sure y'all have all read this book, right? Good to Great. Came out in 2001. So I was like, all right, these were the most innovative companies back then. Let's go and take a look and see what happened to these companies. Nucor Steel has done fine. Its rate of return, its annualized rate of return since the day Good to Great was released has been 10%. Kroger has done fine. Its annualized rate of return since the book came out has been 6%. By the way, the market has done about 5%. Inflation has been about 3.5%. Walgreens has done fine, very innovative company, has returned 6% a year annualized to investors. Kimberly-Clark is skidding right on there since 2001. If you'd invested in Kimberly-Clark, you would have gotten 4% per year. Does anybody in here work for Wells Fargo? Because I'm about to trash the hell out of Wells Fargo. Okay, I'm about to talk about innovation. Yes, they had an innovation. They innovated in signing up 5 million false accounts for their customers, which I can't believe that no one that I can tell has really gotten. I guess the chairman resigned. But anyway, how's Wells Fargo done since then? 4%. All right. Abbott Labs has done 3%. Since then, Philip Morris, so now we're treading under the level of even inflation, right? From the Good to Great book. Philip Morris, well, they got in all kinds of trouble, but they've returned 2% since then. Pitney Bowes, which really doesn't do much of anything now except it's a patent company. They basically license patents. But anyway, that's the return. They were in Good to Great, and if you'd bought it when Good to Great came out, you would have had a negative 7% return. Circuit City has done as well as Dead Elvis. That's Dead Elvis up there, by the way. Circuit City disinnovated themselves right out of existence. Fannie Mae, Dead Elvis, but then came back. as kind of a zombie thing now. Nobody's really sure what they are, except they're getting government support. So they're kind of a zombie, but I think they deserve to be as dead as Elvis. Gillette, I'm gonna have a word to talk about later. They got assimilated into another company. But basically, an Apple, this is what I don't understand. Why was Apple not in that book in 2001? If you had bought all these innovative, allegedly innovative companies way back then, you would have had an annual return of roughly 2%. Not much at all, and way less than the market. These were supposed to be the innovative companies. Why were they not innovative? What was going on in this book? And it turns out, I believe, that a lot of these companies were disinnovative. And let me explain what that is. So 3 out of the 11 companies that were great companies wound up beating the S&P 500, while Apple, during that same time period, earned 34% a year, and its total return over the same time period was 8,200%. All right, why was that not recognized at that time, their innovation? I did a lot of work on Walmart. I made a film about Walmart called Why Walmart Works, and which kind of is a strange title. But anyway, I made the film about Walmart, and I studied them for a long time, and for a long time, they were one of the most innovative companies in America. That's how they grew. And it's because Walmart is less a store than it is an IT machine. It's gotten like a sort of hidden identity. That's Hal from 2001, A Space Odyssey. Are y'all old enough to recognize that? You know how Hal got his name? Thank you, sir. If you raise the letters of Hal 1, it's HAL becomes IBM. All right, and so, but what I like to tell people is Walmart's not a store. It's an IT machine, in reality, with Sam Walton's brain sort of plugged into it. And if you're kind of weird like me and you look at aerial pictures of Walmart late at night, which is what I do, kind of, sometimes, maybe, it sort of looks like a computer chip in a lot of ways. There are the inputs and the inputs being the trucks bringing the goods in, the outputs being the goods leaving the store and all the processing going on in between. Walmart was an incredibly innovative company. We're in Florida, so Walmart's algorithms predicted everything, and what it would do is it would, under different weather circumstances, Walmart's computers would order things without any human intervention. So, for instance, if a hurricane is coming towards Ponte Vedra, Florida, Walmart would know to order two things. The computer, without any human intervention, would order two things. What are y'all drinking right now? Water. I don't think so. Beer, all right. Walmart's computers knew that based on past purchases, in a hurricane, people liked beer and they also liked strawberry Pop-Tarts. That's comfort food in a hurricane. But that's one of the things that made Walmart so innovative, right? Walmart became incredibly innovative by finding out as much about their customers as they could, by keeping their customers that they had and bringing in new customers by figuring out what their needs were gonna be. Also, if you go in on Friday, the two most highly correlated items, in other words, if you buy one, you're probably gonna buy another, are beer and, you were right, how'd you know? Beer and diapers. Anybody get my NASA joke? Told you couldn't take a picture of me. Not while I'm wearing Spanx. You can't take a picture of me. Just teasing. Anyway, but Walmart, what they did was they innovated in taking scale and IT and meshing them together and keeping the customers they had and getting new customers. 135 million people 10 years ago, 135 million people per week would walk into a Walmart. Okay? Now things have sort of changed. Oh, they applied their innovation and got rid of Circuit City pretty quickly. We showed them already. They became a record label. The only place you could get this Eagles album was at Walmart. Walmart wound up selling 55% of all the toys in the United States when they put their innovation to it. I photoshopped that. That's not a real product. No. They became the fourth largest bank in Mexico within about 3 years, all right? When they applied their innovation, they could do wonderful things. They even got in this business, All right, and the interesting thing, this is one of my favorite slides ever, because if you look, I don't know if you can read it from here, but if you look at the second slide, the Lady de Guadalupe casket, steel casket, which must be comfortable, which sells for $895. What is notable about that slide? It's got ratings. Explain that one to me, please. I'm all in on that casket. I'm there. This was what people normally think of as Walmart's customer demographic. I did a lot of studies on this. This is what I wound up with, okay? This is who, all right, you ask, sir, what are grabblers? Ask, what are grabblers? Grabblers, sir, I'm glad you asked that, are people who do dumb things like this. That is me on the right, Ron Galloway with the catfish, the 75-pound catfish, that almost killed me, okay? Because when I grabbed it, I went 18 feet underwater with breathing apparatus and let him swallow my arm. Ah! Yeah, I know. Pretty smart, huh? But anyway, that's what people thought were Walmart shoppers. But it belies the fact that Walmart was gathering customers from all sorts of demographic groups, from higher demographic income groups. Then, about 10 years ago, Walmart, who had been innovating like crazy, decided to start picking fights politically. They decided to kind of not concentrate as hard on logistics and let the stores get messy. So you can see right here, customers flee Walmart for Target, Costco. Walmart losing millennial shoppers to Dollar General. I love Dollar General. How many of y'all shop at Dollar General? I love Dollar General. Walmart, the awakening of an environmental giant. All of a sudden, Walmart decided to become a political animal. And I'm not really sure why, even though I was involved in a lot of that battle with them, because I would represent them on TV a lot in this battle. They took a right turn. They, as what I'm about to talk to you about, they disinnovated away from their customers, and people who were normally their customers, is the GOP losing Walmart, people that would normally shop at Walmart stopped shopping there because of the political stances that they were taking. Walmart was not gathering in new customers, and they were driving away old customers. And this goes to the heart of the argument that I've been trying to think through on all this. In general, if you look up innovation in the dictionary, it's something where you make changes in something established, especially by introducing new methods, ideas, or products. Dis, the prefix, denotes reversal or absence of an action or state. So therefore, to disinnovate would be to not advance. All right, or even to go backwards, or to decide to not make changes. All right, and this is where my definition of innovation is going to kind of take a left turn as I explain disinnovation. The purpose of a business, a lot of people say, well, it's to maximize shareholder value. They say lots of things. The purpose of a business, I believe, is not gross revenue. It's not profits per se. It's not EBITDA, which I still haven't figured out what that is. The purpose of, every time you hear it on CNBC, I'm just like, really? You don't want to trust a company that gets up there and talks about EBITDA all the time. The purpose of a business is the creation and preservation of customers, because everything flows from that. Your EBITDA, whatever that is, flows from that. Your profits flow from that. You have to create and preserve customers. That's the purpose of a business. So if you sort of rejigger the idea of what innovation is to make changes in something established, especially by introducing new methods, ideas, or product that cause progress in people's lives, which is what makes people buy things. Why do people buy the iPhone? Why does everybody buy the iPhone? Because it allows them to make progress in their life and do things easier. It does not move them backwards. Now, I don't have an iPhone. I did. My friend Dell, who's here right now, makes fun of me because I still have an Android phone, but then again, I do Java programming on it, so that's why I use it. But in general, if you make people's lives better, for example, the iPhone, you'll have, well, in their case, what you have is the most successful product in the history of the world, if you look at the numbers, all right? It's the single most successful product. The purpose of innovation, I believe, ultimately, if you wrap it up in the way that I've been thinking about it, is you make changes in something established that results in the creation or preservation of customers. So you hold on to what you got, plus hopefully you get new customers in. Therefore, Disinnovation would be making or refusing to make changes in something established, resulting in no new customers and driving away existing customers. So, if you accept my argument that the purpose of a business is to retain, you know, to retain customers and get new ones, and you accept what I've defined innovation as, then disinnovation is refusing to make changes that would keep customers or making changes that drive people away. All right, does that make sense? It's kind of a weird concept, which is why, like I said, it's taken me a little while to wrap my head around it. And so what I wanted to do is give you some examples of companies that have been disinnovated. How many of y'all have a Blackberry? You still do? Right on. You are disinnovative. No, dude, you're bi Blackberry. Did I say that? No, they're fantastic. But remember, everybody used to have them. But let me show you how they disinnovated. This is Nokia, and I'm going to use Nokia and Blackberry. It's sort of the same thing. Nokia and Blackberry's market caps at each iPhone release, all right? At the beginning of iPhone's release, Nokia's market cap was $114 billion. Now, mind you, Nokia was ultimately sold for $4 billion. All right, Microsoft, after they bought them, sold them for $4 billion and then wrote off $9 billion. BlackBerry was $40 billion, and I think their market cap got down to about $2 billion. But look what happened when they refused to follow what Apple was doing. All right? So something came along, they refused to make changes, they stuck with what they had, and their customers left them. Everybody used to have a BlackBerry, then all of a sudden everybody wound up with an iPhone. So that's an example of disinnovation that could have been avoided. This is one of the executives of BlackBerry on the iPhone. He said, it's kind of one more entrant into an already busy space with lots of choice for customers, but in terms of sort of a sea change, I think that's overstating it. It's a refusal. Disinnovation is a refusal to recognize a new entrant, okay? A new entrant that might be innovative. The other co-executive of BlackBerry said of the iPhone, try typing a web key on a touchscreen on an Apple iPhone. That's a real challenge. You can't see what you type. Have y'all seen kids typing on iPhones lately? They type so fast, I mean, it's just unbelievable. I don't want to keep trashing them, but later on, as the iPhone was eating their lunch, a BlackBerry executive said, physical QWERTY keyboards were the greatest thing and the most exciting trend in mobile. After Apple launched the iPad, a BlackBerry executive's like, we don't understand tablets, we really don't think they make sense. It's a refusal to recognize what your customers want. That is disinnovation. You're driving your customers away from you, and you certainly aren't getting any new customers. And when they delivered, this may be the actual BlackBerry you have, sir, I'm not sure. The BlackBerry 6 platform, he said, I think you'll be amazed how it's a quantum leap of over everything out there, maybe except the iPhone, who was eating everybody's lunch at the time. And then I'm just gonna read this. This was on a conference call with the head of BlackBerry, and this may be an example of disinnovative thinking. And see how many buzzwords you can count in this. There's tremendous turbulence in the ecosystem, of course, in mobility, and that's sort of an obvious thing, but there's tremendous architectural contention at play. So I'm going to really frame our mobile architectural distinction. We've taken two fundamentally different approaches in their causalness. It's a causal difference, not a nuance. It's not just a causal direction that I'm going to articulate, and feel free to go as deep as you want. It's really as fundamental as causalness. What the fuck did he just say? I have no idea. I can drink a lot of alcohol, and even after a lot of alcohol, I have no idea what that guy said. He just didn't have a clue. Leadership there was disinnovative, although the president still uses a BlackBerry because it's very secure, and some people are completely wedded to them. Okay, Blockbuster wound up being extremely disinnovated, disinnovative. Netflix came to them early on, and they could have had Netflix for $50 million. Netflix wanted to partner up with them, and literally Reed Hastings got laughed out of the room. So what they're doing is they're not seeing forward in an innovative direction. They're not anticipating their customers' needs, all right? And they wound up being disinnovative. Now, here's the interesting thing about Blockbuster's business model. Blockbuster's business model at the time was based upon not keeping customers, not getting new customers, but punishing their customers. They were punishing their customers with late fees. Have any of y'all had a Blockbuster late fee over a month? Probably, yeah, you have. That's how they punished you. That's how they were making all their money. They didn't recognize the value of a subscription model. They disinnovated on that point. Netflix didn't have retail locations. They didn't charge late fees. They did all these things which Blockbuster really just had blinders on and couldn't see, and Blockbuster got disinnovated right out of business. MySpace, how many of y'all had a MySpace account? Really, that's all? Wow. Anyway, MySpace was just the stuff, all right? When they were around, they were just the stuff. And what happened was Facebook came out, and even one of the founders of Facebook said, look, if they had just done a few things and paid attention to their customers and not made the experience so awful for their customers, they would have beaten us. But they didn't, and Facebook now is about a $160 billion company, I think, because MySpace was trying to get as much ad revenue as they could, and by doing that, they were ignoring the needs of their users, making their platform unusable, and letting Facebook slip right through and disinnovate them right out of business. So disinnovation, as I'm seeing, is making or refusing to make changes. They're both equal in something established, resulting in no new customers and driving away existing customers. Now, those are companies in the past. Who's disinnovating right now? Well, let's start with NASCAR. Thank you very much. They are just like, they are, how would you describe NASCAR right now? Sucking wind? Right. Okay. NASCAR's customers are rednecks, right? Well, partially. No, ma'am, you're not. You're quite lovely. Where do you live? Oh, right on. So NASCAR is like closing good old racetracks, right? They closed two good racetracks, small racetracks, and they built the giant one, or they're using the giant one, out in Las Vegas, and one other huge one for people that don't watch NASCAR, and this is what happens to them, all right? And they move from Fox to FS1. Well, a lot of the people, not making judgments here, but a lot of the people that watch Fox or watch NASCAR can't afford or don't have cable, right? So they're just ignoring the needs of their customers. They're changing the rules after the race. And if you look at Twitter feeds on NASCAR, see, NASCAR's in trouble and no one wants to talk about it. Fans explain why they stop attending NASCAR races. If you just do a Twitter search for NASCAR losing fans, it'll blow the top of your head off. People are really mad at them. They're disinnovating their fans away, and they're certainly not trying to attract new fans by having a racetrack out in the middle of the desert in Las Vegas where nobody really cares about racing. That is disinnovation. Cable TV. Could we be any more disinnovative than cable TV? How many of y'all have cut the cord? All right, that's a lot. Okay, that's like about 10 people in this room that have completely cut the cord because, well, I'll give you an example. My mom lives in an assisted living facility out in Augusta, Georgia, where I'm from. My mom watches Fox News, and that's it. And my mom pays $150 a month for the privilege of watching one channel. This whole thing of bundling channels punishes your customers who really only want to watch, to my mind, HGTV and maybe some sports every once in a while. Because when I ask audiences what they watch, in general, it's basically just HGTV. But the cable TV model, they realize they're going back to being a dumb pipe, which is why they're all trying to acquire so much content right now. And they realize the innovative trend that their customers want, the way to get new customers and keep the ones they already have, is make channels apps like they are on the Apple TV or like they are on the Fire TV. How many of y'all have the Fire TV? It is wonderful. And the Apple TV is wonderful too. I have both of them. But that business is going through a sea change, and the cable companies are being disinnovated right out of it because they're not giving their customers, they're refusing to change and give their customers what they want. Politically, how would y'all describe the segment of the population that watches Fox News? Conservative or liberal? All right, I heard one person say liberal. All right. For the most part, it's conservative. Let me take you back to my mom's assisted living facility, where everybody used to only watch Fox News. Fox News now is not the preferred channel out there because they feel as though Fox News has gotten too liberal for them. Do you agree? So have they chased you away yet? Are they sort of disinnovating away from you? And Megyn Kelly, who seem to be a very nice person, is changing the entire direction of Fox News. Fox is disinnovating away. They're not staying with who brung them to the dance. Let me put them that way. And I'm doubtful that a bunch of MSNBC watchers are going to be jumping over and talking proudly about what they saw on Fox News that night. They're chasing people away by disinnovating away from their customers. They're not creating new customers. This one's such a layup, I almost didn't want to put it in here. You know, it's just too easy about how the NFL is disinnovating. Here's how I know they're disinnovating. My kids and their friends, I do a lot of carpooling, and my son is 14, and it used to always just be NFL this, NFL that, blah, 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 Madden this, Madden that. All right, over the last year or so, it's Premier League this, or UFC that, or we're going to play FIFA on video games. They never talk about the NFL anymore. And I have so many friends, this is anecdotal, that don't watch the NFL anymore. Now, I'm not going to sit here and hate. My ex-wife is a breast cancer surgeon, right? And they do the pink-shaded marketing, which is fine, but they do it for the entire month of October, right? That just might seem to be to the type of 72% of the people that watch the NFL are male, and pink flags might be a little bit of overkill, and it also leaves male thinking, well, where are our prostate cancer flags? I'm not sure what color they would be, but where are our blue? Seriously? Thank you. I actually flew on a plane with a bunch of ladies who had Crohn's disease, and they all had brown shirts, and it was just hilarious, and they were so super nice. But I did not know that prostate cancer, which if you live long enough, if you're a man and you live long enough, you're going to get prostate cancer, all right? It's going to happen. No attention has been paid to that at all. What they're trying to do is drive in female viewers, but in the process, between that and the officiating and the four-hour games with 11 minutes worth of play time, you know, or the people targeting quarterbacks, is driving people away. This red zone, NFL red zone, have any of y'all tried red zone? NFL red zone was what they thought that was going to be their big innovation, and it was, and it's an interesting innovation in that you can watch a lot of games at once and see all the good parts at once, you know, really super quickly. Well, guess where the bulk of NFL revenue comes from? TV, right? Who's going to sit through a four-hour TV game when they can see 11 minutes worth of football when they can turn on red zone for 30 minutes and scoot through the entire day? That's an innovation that wound up becoming, that's a new word. I disinnovated my way right into that word. That it became a major disinnovation for them. And I think they'll probably wind up getting rid of it. They've got so many problems, I hate to pile on them, but it's a fact that their revenue, their Sunday night revenues are down 22%. All right, in TV land, that's a whole lot. Then, rather, they're doing sort of the same thing NASCAR's doing. They're overexposing the product. We have Monday Night Football, which was okay. We all kind of liked that. Then Sunday Night Football came on, and it's like, okay. Then Thursday Night Football came on, and it's like, all right. Then you go to Britain, and you have to wake up at 9 o'clock in the morning to watch NFL football. They're overexposing It's like putting out a new Star Wars movie every week. They're overexposing the product. That's probably not what you want to do. Why Thursday night is bad for football? I have a friend that's a coach in the NFL, and he said it's bad for football because his players are so beat up they can't play. They're just hammered from the last Sunday. And this is a sports writer who said we're reaching our breaking point with the NFL, and I think we are, because there's other entertainment choices like Premier League and UFC that people can go to. Now, I'm from Augusta, so I'm biased. Contrast that with the National, the Masters, all right? The Masters, they have coverage on Thursdays and Fridays, a little bit of coverage. On Saturdays and Sundays, they come in, they don't show it all day. They come in at 1 o'clock in the afternoon and show the back nine. That's it. Now, occasionally if something big happens at the earlier holes, they'll show that, but you get familiar with the course because you see the same holes year after year and you know what might happen on this hole, but they've created scarcity and value, and they're paying attention to the people who pay money, good money, for those tickets. And when you watch it this next year, you're not going to believe it, because what they did, there was a neighborhood across the street from the Augusta National with 180 houses. They bought all the houses, and they made like this giant golf theme park for the people that came to attend, because it was really kind of a crowded place to go to, and it's just beautiful, and you're not going to believe it when you see it. But they're innovating towards their customers and allowing room to attract new customers into the game. So they're innovating, they're not disinnovating. All right, I said I was going to talk about Gillette. This to me is like the very essence of disinnovation. I'm not going to sit here and count the razors on that razor, but it's too many razors on that razor. How many razors is enough? At what point do we reach, I mean, what kind of hair do you have for that fifth razor to get to it? All right, it has to be like subcutaneous on a bone somewhere to get that thing. That's the most ridiculous thing I've ever seen. And that thing is like $25, right? Get this. This is what the markup is on that razor. Nearly 5,000%, right? All right, even though I cut the hell out of myself every time I do it, this is what I use. I use a safety razor. That was like $30, and I buy 1,000 blades for $15. Or I could buy 5 blades at Costco with the Gillette Super Max Fusion 812 stroke 97 and get 5 blades. Which would you do? That's moving, I contend Gillette is moving away from their customers. And my friend Dell was telling me when I showed her this, she said, oh, that's what everybody's, that's sort of the thing now, is to have the old-timey razor. And I think it's because people, A, it gives you an incredibly close shave, and you better have one of those skeptic sticks with you because you're going to cut yourself to death. But people are tired of paying $5 for a razor blade. You're moving away from your customers, and you're not attracting new ones. Netflix, going back to them, I think is disinnovating now, because they've decided to get, all right, House of Cards was great, I would agree, but Netflix, do I really want to see the 7 Adam Sandler movies that Netflix is spending $100 million to get, all right? Netflix has a series, apparently, I haven't seen it, but it's called The Get Down, which costs $16 million per episode to make. That's nearly, actually, $200 million a year for an episode on Netflix. Netflix is disinnovating right now by not going out and getting the best movies and making their customers happy, but spending money on a bunch of stuff that people might or might not watch and trying to become a big content. They went from a content aggregator to a content provider, and I think that's where they're going to lose their edge, as ESPN is completely losing their edge. And the last quarter, ESPN lost 700,000 subscribers. That's a lot. If you take 4 million subscribers in the last year times $7 per month, because all of you with a cable subscription, whether you watch ESPN or not, you're paying, what's 7 times 12? I went to Georgia Tech. I should be able to do this. You're paying, okay, and then that's after tax, so pre-tax, 110 maybe. You're all paying $110 for a channel you might not watch. But if they lose 4 million subscribers in a year times $7 a month, oh God, help me with the math. 4 million times 7 a month, that's 28 million a month, times 12. It's a lot of money that they're losing because they're moving away from their customers. And I don't know if you've been watching them, but on certain things, they've been getting overtly political and driving people away that used to watch them. They've turned into sort of a really big political machine rather than just sports, which is what people want to watch. Twitter has also turned very political and is chasing people away for that reason too. My favorite, I follow Ambrose Evans Pritchard, and he decided that they were just getting one-sided and deleting his tweets. Twitter, if they were too far right, Twitter would just close him down. He's like, you know what, I'm out of here. That's why Twitter can't find anybody to buy them, because they realize that as a business, they're disinnovating. Facebook can be accused of that a little bit. Now, I've been hammering on companies, but who's been re-innovating? Maybe who went through something and is coming out the other side and recognize their mistakes. One name, I give a lot of healthcare speeches, and one name that really pops to mind to me is CVS. If you talk in terms of keeping old customers and going out and getting new ones. All right, it kind of all started when they kicked the cigarettes out of the store, right? It's like, they made a lot of money on cigarettes, but they kicked them out. Well, why'd they do that? Because they're trying to drive more people in, because CVS is going big time. This is from their, a PowerPoint, into retail healthcare clinics. All right, you can't be selling cigarettes in a place where you're also providing healthcare, I don't believe. And what they're going to do by the end of this year, they're wanting to have 1,500 locations. All right, there's 4,000 Walmarts in the United States. CVS is planning to have 1,500, is that the number? Yeah, 1,500 health clinics. They're expanding their customer base and making it more convenient for new customers to come someplace to get health care, as well as keeping the customers they already have. They are re-innovating into a new area. I don't know if y'all watched the September Apple event. The biggest line of applause came when the guy that invented Mario, when Tim Cook introduced him, because people have been waiting for Mario to come to the iPhone, all right? And Nintendo was disinnovating for a long time because they were like, we're a hardware company. We have to sell hardware. At some point they realized, probably looking at Angry Birds and other apps like that, we can't be selling hardware anymore. They only sold 1.7 million of the Nintendo Wii U, and there really weren't any games from that, or games for it. So what they realized was, our customers are not buying our hardware anymore. We need to make a turn and put our software on the platforms that they're already using, so we keep our old customers who love Mario and we get new ones. That's actually one of my favorite examples about re-innovating. And I have to sort of close on this with Apple, because they get picked on all the time. People hate on them all the time. They hated on them when they got rid of the floppy drive. All right, they hated on them when they got rid of the earphone plug and they went to the lightning plug. But those are all innovations that ultimately are going to help their customers, because actually the new headphones that they're using with that can do some amazing things. People are giving them a lot of hell right now for this touch bar. They're like, that's not innovative where the F1 through 16 keys used to be. But if you really look at it and play with it, and I have, it can do some amazing things. It's an innovation that people aren't seeing yet, that Apple is really not getting credit for. The thing about Apple, and I think the reason people pick on them so much, is, you know, people are like, Apple's disinnovating. You know, they're going away from innovation. Well, at least they're not inventing a phone that blows up on a plane. Have you flown on a plane lately? Did they give you the announcement about the Samsung Note? Yes, they did. That's not good advertising. Please don't bring your phone on the plane, because you're going to blow it up. Apple keeps getting better and better, and here's where I think Apple's, what Apple's innovation plan really is. All right, people took a look at the iPhone 7, and you know it's a wonderful device. Here's where I think they're going long term. Y'all saw the AirPods. What are they called? Airbuds? AirPods? The things that go in your ear. Here's where I think they're going. The iPhone 7 is as powerful as a MacBook Air from 2 years ago as a computer. AirPlay exists on those phones. I think what's going to happen and where Apple is heading towards to keep the customers they have and get new ones is I believe they're going to stop making desktops, all right? I think your desktop computer is going to be your phone. You're going to set it next to your monitor, which will wirelessly transmit via AirPlay to your monitor, and your phone is going to be a combination of your watch and the earbuds. That's where I think they're going with all this, all right? It's not just, I mean, the iPhone will always be around, but I think they're segueing that into being your personal computer and making your phone, and those AirPods won't always be that ugly, obviously. This is version one. They do look a little weird. But pretty soon they'll be hidden like some hearing aids can be hidden. And I think that's where they're aiming to go with the phone, along with making it a health device that, for those of y'all that do elder care, healthcare clinics for the elderly, is going to be absolutely invaluable because by then it will be regulated by the FDA as a medical device because it'll take pulse, it probably will take blood pressure, the accelerometer can tell when somebody falls down. It's going to make it a lot easier for seniors to live by themselves. So seniors are going to have, they're going to be wearing one of these things, and it's also going to be their phone, and it's going to be their method of payment. I think that's where Apple is heading. They're attracting new customers, and they're going to hold on to the Apple fanboys like me, who pretty much buy everything they have. Okay, most disinnovative product of all time. I'm going to finish up with this. What would y'all think the most disinnovative product of all time is? I like Chia Pets, man. I'll give you a hint. But it's not Pudding Pops. It's not Pudding Pops. He was the spokesman for... And look at that a second and tell me how inappropriate that slide is, by the way. Just take a second and read the... I know. I went there. I really did. New Coke, most disinnovative product of all time. Got no new customers and drove everybody away. Complete disinnovation. And I'm going to finish now with the most disinnovative company of all time. Who would y'all guess it is? Anybody? Kodak did. Oh, get this. Guess who else Bill Cosby was a spokesman for? Kodak. And there was one other company that went under that he was a spokesman for. Can't remember. TI Computers. TI Personal Computers. Yeah. Everything he touched just totally went to crap. It's amazing. Anyway, I believe the most disinnovative company of all time is the company whose CEO made these statements. I don't think anybody has a product that is the product I see customers wanting. No one has a product you can use, not Apple, not Google, not Amazon. Linux is a cancer that attaches itself in an intellectual property sense to everything it touches. We will out-innovate Google in key areas, in search, in news search. We're going to do everything we can about innovation. You don't need a computer scientist to use a Windows phone. I think you do to use an Android phone. Have y'all seen some of the people like in malls using Android phones? They're not computer scientists, I pretty much guarantee you. And here's my favorite quote from the head of this most dysfunctional, disinnovative company. There's no chance that the iPhone is going to get any significant market share. No chance. So y'all know who I'm talking about now, right? Steve Ballmer from Microsoft made all those remarks. Microsoft had everything going for them. They had to do one thing right. They have one job. Keep the operating system stable. They get sidetracked. They gave us the Zune. They gave us Windows ME. This was going to be their big social experiment that Microsoft Ken Do y'all remember the Kin? No, because it lasted 2 freaking weeks. Verizon ripped it off the shelves. Windows Vista. How many Vista fans in the audience tonight? Yeah, about as many as, you know, air supply fans. You know, probably not a lot in the audience tonight. IE6, Internet Explorer 6, was called the least secure software on the planet. Y'all remember Microsoft Bob? God, good for you. The Windows Phone. How many of y'all are rocking the Windows Phone right now?
I'm part of the 1%.
There you go. There you go. And the Surface Tablet, this is my favorite. We're like, we're going to copy the iPad. Surface Tablet's going to be everything to everybody. When they introduced it, it froze on stage when they were introducing it. But it gets even better. They struck a deal with the NFL, so all these goofballs acted like they were looking at these Microsoft Surfaces, when in fact a lot of them took the Surface case off and put iPads in there, all right? But they're like, oh, Microsoft Surface is great. Well, yeah, you know what? Tell that to the most successful NFL coach of all time. I just can't take the Microsoft Surface anymore, and you can't read it, but he says, paper is better than the Microsoft Surface.
Amen.
All right? Do you have a Microsoft Surface? I am so sorry. There's free drinks out there. Oh, well, you could have brought it out here and thrown it in the lake. It's just like, it's a total disinnovation. It drove people away and got no new customers. So the purpose of a business, I believe, is, and then this new one that came out looks just like an iMac, is not profits, not EBITDA. It's the creation and preservation of customers, because that's what everything flows from. And when you innovate, if you take that as your driving star, then innovation is making changes in something by introducing new methods that will attract new customers. And the way you attract and keep customers is by making their lives better. You create or preserve customers by creating, not casting, progress in their lives. Disinnovation, as I'm working this through, is making or refusing to make changes in something established, resulting in no new customers and driving away existing customers. I went a little long. Thank you very much for your kind attention and laughing at my jokes, and have a great evening.